Hi, everybody.
It is I, Christopher. I have returned to read 2 Samuel, 10th book of the Bible. And it is an interesting thing about Samuel. I was reading that he is the only prophet that two books are named after him, the second of which he's not even in. I also read somewhere that in the Septuagint, I think, and also in the Vulgate, the Latin Vulgate, I think, that Samuel is one book. And also I read that 2 Samuel, I was reading that 2 Samuel was known as the third book of Kings. Although, I don't know how that is true, those two statements, because I thought I read that Septuagint said that it was the second book, or the third book of Kings, because it's all about King David and his rise as a king, his failures, successes, and his defeats, and the hand of God in the life of a man who is fallible, like we all are. It's a good book. The whole book is a good book. But first, I would like to share the gospel really quickly. Jesus is the Lord and Savior. He is also God. He is one with the Father and the Holy Spirit. They are one. They are one God. They are not three gods. They are one God, but three persons. In the very beginning, in the book of Genesis, God was referred to as Elohim, which is plural. He is the one who wrote that book. He is the one who caused Moses to write the texts, the words of that book. And God identified himself as Elohim, plural. And he also said, when he created man, "Let us make man in our image." So he is not just one person. He's three persons, but one God. How that works, I don't fully know. I am human, and I am his creation. I believe what he says, and if I don't see what I believe in his word, or I see something different than what I believe in his word, then I do my best to change what I believe to conform with what he says, because he's God, and he knows everything. And so God, from the beginning, man was created perfect and holy, but he sinned. He fell, and in the garden, God commanded Adam to not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And then he created Eve for Adam, a helper from his side. And then Satan, a fallen angel who was created before the earth and before man, was on the earth at that time and tempted Eve, and he deceived her. Then she took of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil, ate of it, and then gave it to her husband. Adam disobeyed God and listened to his wife rather than to God. And sin entered the world at that time. Death entered the world at that time. God said that, "Do not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and in the day that you do, you shall surely die." So Adam became separated from God. He died spiritually, and he started to experience corruption. And all the earth, everything that was under Adam — Adam was the chief of all God's creation on the earth. He had dominion over it all. And when he sinned, he allowed death into the world. And Satan had taken dominion from Adam, in that he had the power of sin and death. So everybody who was ever born after Adam and Eve were born in their sins. We are all born in our sins. We're all guilty before God. But God, from the foundation of the world, had a plan. None of this surprised him. He predestined and he foreordained a plan and a purpose, and that was Jesus. So when the time was right to fulfill many hundreds of prophecies in the Old Testament about Jesus, he came on the earth. He was born through a virgin, Mary, which was prophesied in Isaiah, that he would come through a virgin, and that he would be known as Elohim, God with us. So God was his father, and Mary was his mother. So he was fully human through Mary and fully God through the Holy Spirit, causing him to be conceived in Mary. And he was the Word. John calls him the Word and says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and that God became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So when Jesus grew up as a man, he was perfect and sinless. He never broke God's law. He was tempted like we were. He had weaknesses like we were as humans, but he did not sin. He was not subject to sickness and disease and death because he had no sin. And then he, at the time when it was right, he went into the wilderness to be baptized by John the Baptist, who was also prophesied to come. And when John baptized him, the Holy Spirit descended and remained upon Jesus in the form of a dove. And then the Father spoke from heaven and said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Jesus went into the wilderness to fast for, or into the desert to fast for 40 days, and he was tempted by Satan, and he did not give in. He did not fall to the temptations of Satan. And then he went out preaching the gospel of the kingdom. He said, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. He raised the dead. He cast out devils. He healed the sick. He opened blind eyes. He opened deaf ears. He preached the gospel of the kingdom. He preached the gospel to the poor, poor in spirit, those who know that they need a savior. We're all in need of a savior. We're all guilty before God, and our conscience testifies of that. It's a God-given knowing in our being. Con means with, and science is knowledge. With knowledge, we know that we are sinners. We know that we have broken God's law, and we're guilty before him. And Jesus said, turn from your sin and follow me. Believe that I am he, that I am the Christ, the anointed one, the prophesied one to come, and you will be saved. And then he raised up disciples, taught them to go out and preach the same message he preached, the gospel of the kingdom, and to do the same works he did, heal the sick, cast out devils, raise the dead, and many signs and wonders through him, through faith in him. And they did that. They delivered people from demons, they healed the sick, and they preached the gospel. Then Jesus, at a right time, gave himself up as a guilty man, even though he was innocent, perfectly innocent. He became our sin so that we might become his righteousness. And so when he gave himself up, he was prosecuted by the Romans. He was sentenced to death. He was whipped and scourged, had his flesh torn off his back. He was rejected by all who knew him. He was left alone. And then he was nailed to a cross by his hands and feet. And while he was on that cross, even the Father abandoned him for a time. He said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He became our sin. He became us so that we don't have to suffer the punishment of our own sins. He took that on himself. And the wrath of God was poured out on him. And then he died on that cross. He was pierced in his side by a Roman soldier, and out flowed blood and water. He was taken down from that cross, buried in a grave, and then he rose from the grave 3 days later. He was seen by all his followers and by over 500 people at one time. And so he defeated Satan, he defeated death, and he brought about the salvation, the atonement, the payment for our sins, and then the ability for us to receive eternal life. And then he walked the earth for 40 more days, preached the gospel of the kingdom, and he told his disciples to wait in Jerusalem for the promise of the Father. In the Old Testament, God promised to pour out his Spirit on all flesh, and that he would give us a new heart. He would make us a new creation. And so he went and ascended back up to heaven. After those 40 days, the disciples watched him go up to heaven. He floated, levitated back to heaven. And then the disciples waited in Jerusalem for 10 more days. The Holy Spirit was poured out, and they prophesied and spoke in tongues, new languages, and by the power of the Holy Spirit. And then they became witnesses to Jesus with power and demonstrations of the Spirit. the Holy Spirit working through them, being the comforter, the teacher, the Spirit of truth. And then they raised up disciples too. From that time, God's kingdom has been growing and nothing can overtake it. It will be forever. And then, so when you die, if you believe in Jesus and you become born again by his Spirit, then you are reunited to Jesus, but you will never see death. You will go to heaven and be with him forever. Then there will be a resurrection. You will be raised from the dead and you will have a glorified body like Jesus had that will never see corruption. It will live forever. And then, so if you don't have Jesus as Lord and Christ, you don't believe in him and put your trust in what he did on the cross to pay for our sin, to take our sin on us so that we could receive his righteousness and become born again by his Spirit, then you will be cast into hell and you will be judged for your sins. And then eventually there will be a resurrection of you as well, but you will be cast into a lake of fire where you would be forever. And God made the way so that we could be saved from all of that through Jesus Christ, through faith in him. So I admonish you, believe the gospel and be saved. When Jesus was whipped and beaten, when his flesh was torn off his back, it says that he also bore our sickness and carried our pains, and by his wounds we are healed. So we can receive healing from him because of what he did on that day when he was whipped and beaten at the whipping post. Or we can give healing to others because it's already completed. Jesus paid the price for that. Matthew in 8:17 of his gospel confirms that. It says that he took our infirmities and bore our sicknesses. And Peter says, by his wounds we were healed. So I can speak to your body now in the name of Jesus because of what he did 2,000 years ago. Be healed, be free, be made whole. Receive the life and the power of God in your body. I command everything that is of the enemy, everything that is dislocated and dysfunctioning, every disease, leave you now in the name of Jesus. Be made whole, be healed now in Jesus Christ's name, and faith in his name and the authority in his name. Jesus means Jehovah is salvation. Salvation to you by the power of the Holy Spirit and faith in the name of Jesus right now. Amen. So I'm going to continue 2 Samuel. Now it came to pass after the death of Saul, when David had returned from the slaughter of the Amalekites, and David had stayed 2 days in Ziklag. On the third day, behold, it happened that a man came from Saul's camp with his clothes torn and dust on his head. So it was when he came to David that he fell to the ground and prostrated himself. And David said to him, "Where have you come from?" So he said to him, "I have escaped from the camp of Israel." Then David said to him, How did the matter go? Please tell me." And he answered, "The people have fled from the battle. Many of the people are fallen and dead, and Saul and Jonathan his son are dead also. So David said to the young man who told him, "How do you know that Saul and Jonathan his son are dead?" Then the young man who told him said, As I happened by chance to be on Mount Gilboa, there was Saul leaning on his spear, and indeed the chariots and horsemen followed hard after him. Now when he looked behind him, he saw me and called to me. I answered, "Here I am." And he said to me, "Who are you?" So I answered him, "I am an Amalekite." He said to me again, "Please stand over me and kill me, for anguish has come upon me, but my life still remains in me." So I stood over him and killed him, because I was sure that he could not live after he had fallen. And I took the crown that was on his head and the bracelet that was on his arm, and I have brought them here to my lord. Therefore David took hold of his clothes and tore them, and so did all the men who were with him. And they mourned and wept and fasted until evening for Saul and for Jonathan his son, for the people of the Lord, and for the house of Israel, because they had fallen by the sword. Then David said to the young man who told him, "Where are you from?" And he answered, "I am the son of an alien, an Amalekite." So David said to him, How was it you were not afraid to put forth your hand to destroy the Lord's anointed?" Then David called one of the young men and said, "Go near and execute him." And he struck him so that he died. So David said to him, "Your blood is on your own head, for your own mouth has testified against you, saying, 'I have killed the Lord's anointed.'" Then David lamented with this lamentation over Saul and over Jonathan, his son. And he told them to teach the children of Judah the song of the bow. Indeed, it is written in the book of Jasher. The beauty of Israel is slain on your high places. How the mighty have fallen. Tell it not in Gath. Proclaim it not in the streets of Ashkelon, lest the daughters of the Philistines rejoice, lest the daughters of the uncircumcised triumph. O mountains of Gilboa, let there be no dew nor rain upon you, nor field of offering or offerings. For the shield of the mighty is cast away there, the shield of Saul, not anointed with oil. From the blood of the slain, from the fat of the mighty, the bow of Jonathan did not turn back, and the sword of Saul did not return empty. Saul and Jonathan were beloved and pleasant in their lives, and in their death they were not divided. They were swifter than eagles, they were stronger than lions. O daughters of Israel, weep over Saul, who clothed you in scarlet with luxury, who put ornaments of gold on your apparel. How the mighty have fallen in the midst of the battle. Jonathan was slain in your high places. I am distressed for you, my brother Jonathan. You have been very pleasant to me. Your love to me was wonderful, surpassing the love of women. How the mighty have fallen, and the weapons of war perished. 2 Samuel chapter 2. It happened after this that David inquired of the Lord, saying, "Shall I go up to any of the cities of Judah?" And the Lord said to him, "Go up." David said, "Where shall I go up?" And he said, "To Hebron." So David went up there, and his two wives also, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess, and Abigail the widow of Nabal the Carmelite. And David brought up the men who were with him, every man with his household, so they dwelt in the cities of Hebron. Then the men of Judah came, and there they anointed David king over the house of Judah. And they told David, saying, "The men of Jabesh Gilead were the ones who burned Saul, or buried Saul." So David sent messengers to the men of Jabesh Gilead and said to them, "You are blessed of the Lord, for you have shown this kindness to your Lord, to Saul, and have buried him. And now may the Lord show kindness and truth to you. I also will repay you this kindness because you have done this thing. Now therefore let your hands be strengthened and be valiant, for your master Saul is dead, and also the house of Judah has anointed me king over them." But Abner, the son of Ner, commander of Saul's army, took Ish-bosheth, the son of Saul, and brought him over to Mahanaim. And he made him king over Gilead, over the Asherites, over Jezreel, over Ephraim, over Benjamin, and over all Israel. Ish-bosheth, Saul's son, was 40 years old when he began to reign over Israel, and he reigned 2 years. Only the house of Judah followed David. And the time that David was king in Hebron over the house of Judah was 7 years and 6 months. Now Abner, the son of Ner, and the servants of Ish-bosheth, the son of Saul, went out from Mahanaim to Gibeon. And Joab, the son of Jeruiah, and the servants of David went out and met them by the pool of Gibeon. So they sat down, one on one side of the pool and the other on the other side of the pool. Then Abner said to Joab, "Let the young men now arise and compete before us." And Joab said, "Let them arise." So they arose and went over by number, 12 from Benjamin, followers of Ish-bosheth, the son of Saul, and 12 from the servants of David. And each one grasped his opponent by the head and thrust his sword in his opponent's side. So they fell down together. Therefore, that place was called Field of Sharp Swords, which is in Gibeon. So there was a very fiery battle that day, and Abner and the men of Israel were beaten before the servants of David. Now the three sons of Zeruiah were there, Joab and Abishai and Asahel. And Asahel was as fleet of feet as a wild gazelle. So Asahel pursued Abner, and in going he did not turn to the right hand or to the left from following Abner. Then Abner looked behind him and said, "Are you Asahel?" He answered, "I am." And Abner said to him, "Turn aside to your right hand or to your left, and lay hold on one of the young men and take his armor for yourself. But Asahel would not turn aside from following him. So Abner said again to Asahel, turn aside from following me. Why should I strike you to the ground? How then could I face your brother Joab? However, he refused to turn aside. Therefore, Abner struck him in the stomach with the blunt end of the sword, a spear, so that the spear came out of his back, and he fell down there and died on the spot. So it was that as many as came to the place where Asahel fell down and died stood still. Joab and Abishai also pursued Abner, and the sun was going down when they came to the hill of Ammah, which is before Gia, by the road to the wilderness of Gibeon. Now the children of Benjamin gathered together behind Abner and became a unit and took their stand on top of a hill. Then Abner called to Joab and said, shall the sword devour forever? Do you not know that it will be bitter in the latter end? How long it be then until you tell the people to return from pursuing their brethren? And Joab said, as God lives, unless you had spoken, surely then by morning all the people would have given up pursuing their brethren. So Joab blew a trumpet, and all the people stood still and did not pursue Israel anymore, nor did they fight anymore. Then Abner and his men went on all that night through the plain, crossed over the Jordan, and went through all Bithron, and they came to Mahanaim. So Joab returned from pursuing Abner, and when he had gathered all the people together, there were missing of David's servants 19 men and Asahel. But the servants of David had struck down of Benjamin and Abner's men 360 men who died. Then they took up Asahel and buried him in his father's tomb, which was in Bethlehem. And Joab and his men went all night, and they came to Hebron at daybreak. 2 Samuel chapter 3. Now there was a long war between the house of Saul and the house of David, but David grew stronger and stronger, and the house of Saul grew weaker and weaker. Sons were born to David in Hebron. His firstborn was Amnon by Ahinoam the Jezreelitess. His second, Chileab, by Abigail, the widow of Nabal the Carmelite. The third, Absalom, the son of Maacah, the daughter of Talmai, king of Geshur. The fourth, Adonijah, the son of Haggith. The fifth, Shephatiah, the son of Abital. And the sixth, Ithream, by David's wife Eglah. These were born to David in Hebron. Now it was so, while there was war between the house of Saul and the house of David, that Abner was strengthening his hold on the house of Saul. And Saul had a concubine whose name was Rizpah, and the daughter of Ahiah. So Ishbosheth said to Abner, why have you gone into my father's concubine? Then Abner became very angry at the words of Ishbosheth and said, am I a dog's head that belongs to Judah? Today I show loyalty to the house of Saul your father, to his brothers and to his friends, and have not delivered you into the hand of David. And you charge me today with a fault concerning this woman? May God do so to Abner and more also, if I do not do for David as the Lord has sworn to him, to transfer the kingdom from the house of Saul and set up the throne of David over Israel and over Judah from Dan to Beersheba. And he could not answer Abner another word because he feared him. Then Abner sent messengers on his behalf to David, saying, whose is the land? Saying also, make your covenant with me, and indeed my hand shall be with you to bring all Israel to you. And David said, good, I will make a covenant with you. But one thing I require of you, you shall not see my face unless you first bring Michal, Saul's daughter, when you come to see my face. So David sent messengers to Ishbosheth, Saul's son, saying, give me my wife Michal, whom I betrothed to myself for 100 foreskins of the Philistines. And Ishbosheth sent and took her from her husband, from Paltiel, the son of Laish. Then her husband went along with her to Bahurim, weeping behind her. So Abner said to him, "Go, return," and he returned. Now, Abner had communicated with the elders of Israel, saying, "In time past, you were seeking for David to be king over you. Now then, do it, for the Lord has spoken of David, saying, 'By the hand of my servant David, I will save my people Israel from the hand of the Philistines and the hand of all their enemies.'" And Abner also spoke in the hearing of Benjamin. Then Abner also went to speak in the hearing of David in Hebron all that seemed good to Israel and the house, the whole house of Benjamin. So Abner and 20 men with him came to David at Hebron, and David made a feast for Abner and the men who were with him. Then Abner said to David, "I will arise and go and gather all Israel to my lord the king, that they may make a covenant with you, and that you may reign over all that your heart desires." So David sent Abner away, and he went in peace. At that moment, the servants of David and Joab came from a raid and brought much spoil with them. But Abner was not with David in Hebron, for he had sent him away, and he had gone in peace. When Joab and all the troops that were with him had come, they told Joab, saying, "Abner, Abner the son of Ner came to the king, and he sent him away, and he has gone in peace." Then Joab, something going in my throat. Get away from me, devil, in Jesus' name. Then Joab came to the king and said, "What have you done? Look, Abner came to you. Why is it that you have sent him away and he is already gone? Surely you realize that Abner, the son of Ner, came to deceive you, to know your going out and your coming in, and to know all that you are doing." And when Joab had gone from David's presence, he sent messengers after Abner, who brought him back from the well of Sirah. But David did not know it. Now when Abner had returned to Hebron, Joab took him aside in the gate to speak with him privately, and there stabbed him in the stomach, so that he died for the blood of Asahel his brother. Afterward, when David heard it, he said, "My kingdom and I are guiltless before the Lord forever of the blood of Abner, the son of Ner. Let it rest on the head of Joab and on all his father's house, and let there never fail to be in the house of Joab one who has discharge or is a leper, who leans on a staff or falls by a sword, or who lacks bread." So Joab and Abishai, his brother, killed Abner because he had killed their brother Asahel at Gibeon in the battle. Then David said to Joab and to all the people who were with him, "Tear your clothes, gird yourselves with sackcloth, and mourn for Abner." And King David followed the coffin. So they buried Abner in Hebron, and the king lifted up his voice and wept at the grave of Abner, and all the people wept. And the king sang a lament over Abner and said, "Should Abner die as a fool dies? Your hands were not bound, nor your feet put into fetters. As a man falls before wicked men, so you fell." Then all the people wept over him again. And when all the people came to persuade David to eat food while it was still day, David took an oath, saying, "God do so to me, and more also, if I taste bread or anything else till the sun goes down." Now all the people took note of it, and it pleased them, since whatever the king did pleased all the people. For all the people and all Israel understood that the day that it had not been the king's intent to kill Abner, the son of Ner. Then the king said to his servants, "Do you not know that a prince and a great man has fallen this day in Israel? And I am weak today, though anointed king, and these men, the sons of Zeruiah, are too harsh for me. The Lord shall repay the evildoer according to his wickedness." 2 Samuel chapter 4. When Saul's son heard that Abner had died in Hebron, he lost heart, and all Israel was troubled. Now Saul's son had two men who were captains of troops. The name of one was Baanah, and the name of the other Rechab, the sons of Rimmon the Beerothite. of the children of Benjamin, for Beeroth also was part of Benjamin, because the Beerothites fled to Gittaim and have been sojourners there until this day. Jonathan, Saul's son, had a son who was lame in his feet. He was 5 years old when the news about Saul and Jonathan came from Jezreel, and his nurse took him up and fled. And it happened, as she made haste to flee, that he fell and became lame. His name was Mephibosheth. Then the sons of Rimmon the Beerothite, Rechab and Baanah, set out and came at about the heat of the day to the house of Ishbosheth, who was laying on his bed at noon. And they came there all the way into the house as though to get wheat, and they stabbed him in the stomach. Then Rechab and Baanah, his brother, escaped. For when they came into the house, he was lying on his bed in his bedroom. Then they struck him and killed him, beheaded him, and took his head, and were all night escaping through the plain. And they brought the head of Ishbosheth to David at Hebron, and said to the king, "Here is the head of Ishbosheth, the son of Saul, your enemy, who sought your life. And the Lord has avenged my lord the king this day of Saul and his descendants." But David answered Rechab and Baanah, his brother, the sons of Rimmon the Beerothite, and said to them, "As the Lord lives, who has redeemed my life from all adversity? When someone told me, saying, 'Look, Saul is dead,' thinking to have brought good news, I arrested him and had him executed in Ziklag, the one who thought I would give him a reward for his news. How much more, when the wicked men have killed a righteous person in his own house on his bed? Therefore, shall not I not now require his blood at your hand and remove you from the earth?" So David commanded his young men, and they executed them, cut off their hands and feet, and hanged them by the pool of Hebron. But they took the head of Ishbosheth and buried it in the tomb of Abner in Hebron. 2 Samuel chapter 5. Then all the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron and spoke, saying, "Indeed, we are your bone and your flesh. Also in time past, when Saul was king over us, you were the one who led Israel out and brought them in. And the Lord said to you, 'You shall shepherd my people Israel and be ruler over Israel.' Therefore all the elders of Israel came to the king of Hebron, and King David made a covenant with them at Hebron before the Lord. And they anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 40 years. In Hebron he reigned over Judah 7 years and 6 months, and in Jerusalem he reigned 33 years over all Israel and Judah. And the king and his men went to Jerusalem against the Jebusites, the inhabitants of the land, who spoke to David, saying, 'You shall not come in, but the blind and the lame will repel you,' thinking, 'David cannot come in here.' Nevertheless, David took the stronghold of Zion, that is, the city of David. Now David said on that day, 'Whoever climbs up by the way of the water shaft and defeats the Jebusites, the lame and the blind who are hated by David's soul, he shall be chief and captain.' Therefore they say, 'The blind and the lame shall not come into the house.' Then David dwelt in the stronghold and called it the city of David. And David built all around from the Milo and inward. So David went on and became great, and the Lord God of hosts was with him. Then Hiram, king of Tyre, sent messengers to David, and cedar trees, and carpenters, and masons, and they built David a house. So David knew that the Lord had established him as king over Israel, and that he had exalted his kingdom for the sake of his people Israel. And David took more concubines and wives from Jerusalem after he had come from Hebron. Also more sons and daughters were born to David. Now these are the names of those who were born to him in Jerusalem: Shammua, Shabab, Nathan, Solomon, Ibhar, Elishua, Nepheg, Japhia, Elishama, Eliada, and Eliphelet. Now when the Philistines heard that they had anointed David king over Israel, all the Philistines went up to search for David. And David heard of it and went down to the stronghold. The Philistines also went and deployed themselves in the valley of Rephaim. So David inquired of the Lord, saying, "Shall I go up against the Philistines? Will you deliver them into my hand?" And the Lord said to David, "Go up, for I will doubtless deliver the Philistines into your hand." So David went to Baal Perazim, and David defeated them there. And he said, "The Lord has broken through my enemies before me, like a breakthrough of water." Therefore he called the name of that place Baal Perazim. And they left their images there, and David and his men carried them away. Then the Philistines went up once again and deployed themselves in the valley of Rephaim. Therefore David inquired of the Lord, and he said, "You shall not go up. Circle around behind them and come up upon them in front of the mulberry trees. And it shall be, when you hear the sound of marching in the tops of the mulberry trees, then you shall advance quickly. For then the Lord will go out before you to strike the camp of the Philistines." And David did so, and as the Lord commanded him. And he drove back the Philistines from Geba as far as Gezer. So I'll finish there. Got up to chapter 5. Next comes the Ark brought to Jerusalem by David. So yeah, there in chapter 5, David defeated the Zion, the city of Jerusalem, by going through a water shaft. That's pretty interesting, isn't it? That was the spring of, I forget the name of that spring now. It's the only source of water native in Jerusalem. Spring, I forget the name of it. But they did bring aqueduct water. They built aqueducts, and Solomon did that, and there was another man too. There was two pools, and then Solomon built another pool, I think, and then built aqueducts to run the water all the way across Israel to Jerusalem so that they have a lot of water for the temple, for the sacrifices and stuff. But yeah, so that's 2 Samuel. If you'd like me to pray for you, reach out to me at lovesflame.com at the Contact Us tab, and I would be more than happy to pray for you and believe for your need, whether it be healing, deliverance, provision, or if you just want to talk or whatever, I'm in there. You can reach me there or other places as well. Thank you for listening, and until next time, grace, peace, and love in Jesus Christ. Bye.